You know, earlier on, not only promoters used to criticize CCI, even investors used to criticize CCI. I don't know why. They were the biggest beneficiaries of CCI.
Yeah.
And suddenly these investors started saying, yeah, now what do we do? Should we invest? There's nobody to, you know, help us, guide us, hold our hands. Now to fill the void created by the abolition of CCI, SEBI was born.
Oh, wow.
That's how SEBI got created.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Connecting the Dots podcast. And today I have someone who's also my idol because I've been reading a lot of his books very early on. And I think I've mentioned it in multiple Instagram stories and multiple lives that I do. So with me today, I have Mr. Anil Lamba himself, who is a pioneer in the financial industry space and insane amount of knowledge to be grasped in today's session. So Anil, again, thank you for coming. Thank you for gracing us with your presence here. I'm very excited for this session.
Thanks, Shashank. Thanks. Pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
So this basic podcast is about connecting the dots. Connecting the dots basically means that what we have connected in the past, when we look backwards, how have we landed up here? So I want to ask you this question with respect to connecting the dots. How did you land up here, right? From your journey perspective, like, how did your investment journey start? How did you do it in school and college? Or what led you to become a CA? Is there like a story behind that?
Apparently, it looks like this is what I was probably destined to do. In a way, I was not the right person for CA. A lot of people think to be in the field of finance, you got to be a maths whiz or something.
Exactly,
and my first subject was maths. My weakest subject was maths. In fact, after my 10th standard, to run away from maths, I chose commerce. Most of my other classmates went in for science, and very sheepishly I used to tell people I've taken BCom. So it was a route which apparently was laid out for me, and I just followed it. In about 12th standard, my brother, older brother, he said, you know, CA is a very good course you can do after 12th. Why don't you do? And everyone was doing those days. And if you do it as an undergrad, you got to pass an entrance exam.
CPT.
Nowadays, they call it CPT. The terminology, coinage has changed. It was called entrance exam then.
And
lots of my classmates were doing. I had no intention of doing so. I didn't even join coaching classes or anything. But closer to the date, even I filled the form. You know, that FOMO thing of stock market. Now, when you pass that entrance, then the next logical step is start CA.
Yeah.
And once you start CA, it's supposed to be, those days it was far more difficult than it is now.
Yeah.
Very few people used to pass. So whether you like it or not, that is your journey. And when you pass out, then your path is cut out for you. So, you know, kind of went into it. But the whole scenario changed. I did it along with BCom, so very soon I cleared it. Then I was hell-bent on setting up my own practice, even though I was most ill-qualified to practice.
Yeah.
Here were we given enough training to be a practitioner day one during my articleship. You know, some firms...
You have to do an internship, articleship, yes.
3 years articleship, but where we did, we had a different kind of a thing. So when I passed out, I didn't know much then. So everything I've learned on the job, but I was somehow keen to start my practice.
Wow.
So the day I passed out, it was like someone was on a leash. Three things started. I started practicing.
Yeah.
Deep down, there was a fear. How will the world know one more CA is added to the group? How the hell will you ever get business? And we were taught all along, CAs can't advertise.
Yeah.
Not that we were allowed to advertise, who had the money to spend. But the fear was there. You know, how will we get clients?
Yeah.
So I started writing columns in newspapers.
Oh, which newspaper?
In Pune, there was a paper called Pune Herald, which later on became Maharashtra Herald, which later on got taken over by Sakal. It became Sakal Times.
Wow.
And
now,
recently, unfortunately, it shut down. Because when I was also doing my law along with, half my CA happened with BCom, other half happened along with law. And the principal of a law college, very renowned man, used to run a legal column in the newspaper. Answering. So that was in my mind. So I said, you know, the best way to let the world know here I am and I know my subject is to display it.
Correct. Correct.
And, so for many years, I mean, this is what I started the same period when I passed out. And I got invitation to teach because all these management colleges look out for fresh CAs.
Yeah.
It was finance subject. So I was, when I got an invitation, and this happened to Symbiosis, the action is, no, I didn't do CA to teach yet. But then you're on cooler thinking, you realize makes sense because as a professional,
yeah,
you know, you don't get all kinds of clients. For the initial clients, you get a very, very elementary stuff.
Yes.
And if you don't practice and you're not going to study anymore because you already passed out,
yeah,
you stay in touch with your subject. And the best way for a professional to do it is to teach. Doctors should teach because
correct. They keep,
you know, repetition brings perfection. Mm. By that logic, reluctantly, I took it on. Mm. But I discovered a passion for teaching. My students were couple of years younger than me. I had just passed out myself, MBA students.
Yeah.
And then I took on hell of a lot of assignments. And I was a practicing CA, but assignment means what? Even if I give a lecture 4 times a week, a lecture is 1.5 hours.
Yeah.
While you're sitting in office, look at your watch, oh, it's time for a lecture, pick up my bike, go give a talk and come back and start practicing. And I thoroughly enjoyed myself. So these three things that started then, profile kept changing, but I still do it till date.
Wow.
From day one onwards, college teaching became a pain soon because as this picked up, you know, it interferes with working hours.
Yeah.
You know, like 3 o'clock in some college and you're sitting with a client and you're looking at your watch.
And you have to go.
and the priority is the lecture because there are 70 people waiting for you over there. I said, no, this is not, it's not fair. But by fluke, then I started getting invitations from companies. My first client was Tata Motors.
Oh, wow. And
then you realize that's a bigger kick.
And what was that basically? I mean, Tata Motors were teaching for the employee.
Yeah. The corporate training.
Corporate training.
So then from college training, it became corporate training. And that was even more fun because those guys are not learning to pass exams.
Correct. That was their life.
Yeah. This is the life. Yeah. And they pay a heavy price if they don't understand. Companies pay a price. Entrepreneurs pay a price. And that didn't interfere with work at all because all assignments were booked 30 days in advance, your calendar log, nothing. So then the companies kept growing, cities kept growing, then started international offers.
Wow.
And the more, and I used to enjoy it, didn't feel like work at all. I loved it. So the more this grew, the more I delegated my CA work. People working for me. Till one day, I handed over my practice to one of my colleagues who was working with me for 16 years at that time. They would take all the clients, go to another office. And that's when I made my hobby my full-time activity.
Wow.
In between, we started a B school also. We ran that for quite a few years. We had our own.
Was it the LAMCOM school?
LAMCOM School of Management.
Wow. Okay.
And we only stopped it when AICT made it compulsory to affiliate with them. We were an autonomous college and we wanted to be autonomous because...
So, yeah, obviously.
Because rightly or wrongly, we thought we know better what to teach. Not that kind of a thing. Because we thought all university curriculums are
outdated and a little boring. Yeah.
But when they made it compulsory, because then we had to toe their line. So it didn't then those things, B school, public programs, corporate programs, traveling all the while. And then you realize there's so much of potential. Everyone need, you know, you when you study the subject, you feel you studied now, the world knew it before you. You are the newcomer.
Yeah.
And then it's a process of discovery how little people know. And people who can't afford not to know.
Yeah.
And they're paying price. The companies are going bankrupt because they didn't understand finance. And ridiculously, they thought they don't need to understand.
Yeah. Why?
Because production guys handle production. Marketing guys handle marketing. So finance guys will handle finance.
Yeah. Nonsense. Yeah.
Finance is everybody's responsibility.
Yeah.
So the more I saw this, the more, you know, even though teaching was a hobby, but mind was a CA trained mind. Now you can see the potential in that. So then you wonder, how do you tap this potential? So then I had 100 trainers with me soon.
You actually trained 100 people?
No, we hired.
Hired 100 trainers
under us. So to tap the potential.
Wow.
Then realized big mistake because each trainer is different.
Yeah. And they would mostly want you, right? I mean, you as an individual.
Right. But to take advantage of the market demand, you should have more people. But the problem is, if everybody is going to be different, then there's no consistency. Then where is the brand going to be built?
Correct.
If you buy a box of cups or glasses, and each glass has a different shape, you can't build a brand. You know, consistency will be there. So, and of course, you realize that there is no connection between a trainer's intelligence and his effectiveness. The most intelligent guys can be the biggest failures when it comes to training. It's a different ball game.
Wow.
So then we said, no, we took a hard decision, took a U-turn. We said, there'll be a single trainer. Good or bad. We'll be consistently good or consistently bad. But single trainer, then let's build an ecosystem around this trainer to take him across the world. Wow. So we started developing technology-based products, e-learning, videos, then the books came, et cetera, et cetera. So whole thing, today we pride ourselves that anyone, anywhere in the world, doing any business, if they need to learn finance, we will have an answer.
Wow.
From solutions which are as cheap as a few hundred rupees, which is the book, to some solutions that go to crores of rupees. Hmm. And in between everything. So depending on your need, depending on your budget, we will make sure we can teach you finance. What I have to still crack is the language problem. I wish I could teach anybody, doesn't matter what language they speak. Today, unfortunately, most of our training is in English. But we're working on that. How to convert our products into every possible language.
Yeah, I think this is something that I realized as well, right? So, I mean, very similar kind of a story where I was pushed into commerce because I couldn't do engineering, number one. And my dad was an engineer. So he was like, Shashank, you have to become an engineer. And I said, nahi samajh mein aata hai biology, chemistry. My maths was also weak. My commerce was good. So I said, I understand commerce. Let me do that. So when I was doing BFM, my dad again urged me to do CA. He's like, engineer nahi bana, to next best is CA. So do that. I couldn't do that as well. Then he tried putting me into CAT and IIM. I said, if I couldn't do those two, I tried that. I couldn't do that as well. And again, a lot of people thought that finance was numbers, not me. I mean, I did BFM as my undergraduate. And then, you know, when I started putting out some videos on YouTube, I said, okay, let me teach people finance. The first comment I got on my video was, sir, what is inflation you're talking about? And I said, okay, for me, that's a very common topic, right? I mean, inflation, sabko pata hona chahiye. I mean, how do you not know what inflation is? That's when I realized, oh shit.
How little people know.
Yes. I'm like, financial literacy has not reached people in our country. Even if it's a basic BCom graduate, he has more knowledge than I think a massive majority of Indians, right? And simple things like how to save, how to make a plan was something which was very difficult for people. And that's when I realized when I got into that. And very similar thought process, right? And I'm like, okay, ground loot. And that's when I think I read your book. That's when my dad gave me your book first and said, read this balance sheet book, right? Romancing the Balance Sheet. And that's when I said, okay, that's why I recommend if anyone wants to learn finance, I'm like, read that first. Itna simple, even I can't explain. Uske baad you go into the advanced books, right? So big problem.
Most people carry a myth with them. Number one, they think finance is not my job, which is absolutely wrong. It's everybody's job. Number two, they think finance is difficult.
Yeah.
I'm wrong because it's a completely common sense subject.
Yeah.
Number three, they think it's boring.
Yeah.
And somebody said that. I said, damn it, I'm talking about money. How can money be boring? Yeah. The most interesting thing in the world is money. So these myths keep people away from the subject.
Yeah. No, I think this is the common misconception. A lot of people think finance means, oh, he's the numbers guy.
Correct.
And you don't have to be the numbers guy.
You don't have to.
I mean, tu paisa kharch kar raha hai, which is stupid, right? You don't.
Numbers means you should know arithmetic. You don't need to know algebra. You don't need to know
complex mathematics. Yeah.
That is not required. 2 + 2 aana chahiye. What is that?
Mad. So I want to ask you one question, right? So when you enter this, did you enter trading and F&O and stuff like that when you were growing up? Because most of the
people... No. I'm not into trading. I'm not a broker.
Yeah.
In fact, I don't even make money by giving stock market advice. I do nothing where I... I don't like to handle anybody's money. It's too...
Correct. It's stress.
You make money for them 10 times, nobody will even thank you. Once you lose it, they won't ever forget you in their lives. And that is the guilt I don't want to stay with.
Yeah.
So, but I've, having said that, I've always had a soft corner for the stock market because I've said it too often. You know, it's a national duty to invest in stocks, and I've explained it too often. So people who've seen it before will report. But I've said it's very, very important and kind of, I don't know, there has been some, portion of me which felt, let's propagate this across the country. Some social contribution to the nation, So I used to run a very large investment event called Invest Fest.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know, the same thing as you said, how much illiteracy is there. I used to write columns. Those days, markets were booming. I'm talking about just before Harshad Mehta scandal happened. I was a fresh CA and I used to write columns and I used to teach and I used to practice. Hmm. And I realized because I was writing, every week you have to think what to write on.
Correct. So
every time a new investment opportunity would come, would analyze it, talk about the pros and cons. And next week you find another one more attractive. And the next week, another one more attractive.
Yeah.
I said, you know, as a professional, we are having a tough time keeping track.
Hmm.
The layman must be completely lost.
Hmm. So, I completely agree. Yeah.
These things were all done on a whim. No plans. So one day sitting in my office, we used to have a bunch of energetic guys. He said, yeah, let us, if people should ideally go institution by institution, bank by bank, compile information, find out what to do, they won't do that.
Hmm.
So people can't go to institutions. Let's bring institutions to the people.
Hmm.
So we conceived this event called Invest Fest, which was an investment awareness and an investment education event.
Hmm.
I don't know why I did it. We realized after starting, we'd bitten off more than we can chew. Then the practical thing hit us. Are where the money going to come? And then everyone started running for sponsorship.
Yeah.
But that event became the largest event in the country. And we ran it for 12 years.
Oh my God. Wow.
And it used to be held in Pune and in Dubai.
Wow.
And NSC and BSC were perpetual partners of ours.
Partners, also, yeah.
Every big financial institution used to participate. And people like Sucheta Dalal and all have been speakers for 3 times.
Wow.
And all the big shots of BSC, NSC, UTI, you name it. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala has been a speaker.
Wow.
So I've seen all, and that's when Harshad Mehta scandal happened. So I've seen, I talk a lot about Harshad Mehta in courses also. So seen a lot of it happening. And then once the Harshad Mehta scandal happened, which happened after the first Invest Fest.
Yeah.
Now, before that, people were irrationally entering the market. Therefore, we said, let's do an investor education event.
Hmm.
So there was a lot of speakers coming to Invest Fest, all free of cost, social activity.
Hmm.
And then post Harshad Mehta scandal, they started equally irrationally exiting the market.
Hmm. Panic sell kind of thing.
So that's also not right there.
Hmm.
So what can we do to bring them back?
Hmm.
Like I said, none of my business, frankly. I'm not a stock exchange. I have nothing to do. I'm not a government. But this was our contribution. How do we bring them back? So I conceived a game that time, which was played with everything real except money, imaginary money. Now, this game has now become popular through
the mock stock. And
mock stock. But I'm talking about 1992.
Wow.
So we called it the Lamcon stock scan. My company is called Lamcon.
Hmm.
We started, because I live in Pune, we announced it in Pune. Oh, it became such a hit. We had a homegrown software to evaluate and give away prizes and so on. That became a hit in Pune.
Huh.
Next year, we got ambitious. So again, it became an annual event. Next year, we took it to Bombay.
Wow.
It became a hit in Bombay. Coincidentally, one day I was in the offices of Business India magazine. That was Business India, the leading magazine, business magazine.
Yeah.
So Mr. Ashok Advani, wonderful gentleman who owns it, I was sitting and talking with him and somehow the talk went to this stock scan.
Hmm.
And he said, that's your game. I didn't even know it. I've always been keen to do something like this. Let's join hands. So they became my partners. Then it became the Business India stock scan. And we took it city by city, almost all over the country, trying to teach people how to invest. So what I'm saying is, I'm not a broker. I don't make money for these things. But somehow I have had that one corner of mine is, you know, whole country should invest. What can we do? So through Invest Fest and stock scan, etc. So to answer your question, since I'm not into it from that angle, investing has never been in forwards and futures and trading.
Is it long-term investing? Is something fundamental?
I always believed in a long-term plan.
Perfect.
But I also have a very big soft corner, which nowadays doesn't make sense, but it did then, for real estate. So my portfolio has undergone a lot of changes. I stocks you can start buying at any time and build it.
Correct.
Could real estate opportunity come, I would liquidate and put it there. And the stock thing would start all over again.
Understood.
So that's been the kind of journey so far as stock market is concerned.
So what is your take on the stock market today? I think you've seen multiple cycles, right? What is happening today?
I am scared, Shashank. I don't think I could be wrong, and I have been wrong since the pandemic.
That's fine. I mean, nobody knows what's going to happen, but it is weird. I mean,
pandemic started, my personal opinion was this market should crash. Businesses are shutting down. Everything is going down.
Exactly. Negative,
and the stock market is going up.
100%. So
there are phases where stock market beats all logic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then he said, no, it'll fall, but goes up further. I said, no, I'm going to wait for it to fall in. So that FOMO thing sets in amongst everybody.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to succumb to that and pick it up at these values.
Yeah.
So I, for one, I'm waiting. I'm not hoping for a crash, but I'm waiting the day the crash happens. I've listed out what I want to buy. I've put prices that at which I want to buy. When it falls to that, one thing I've learned is stock market, don't hurry.
Yeah.
You know, that is where you get in. Oh, you don't do it. Then it goes further. Then it don't. Then you say, no, I've made a mistake. Let me get in. Then you get in at the highest. And then
it falls. Yeah.
You lose all money. So I really don't have an answer for you. What's going to happen? I don't know.
Yeah.
I have a feeling this is not sustainable.
I agree. Yeah, this is something that I saw, right? When the market fell on March 24th, almost down to 25, 26,000 points. And then if you map it after that, 1 year later, it's gone up to 50,000, okay, which is 100% index.
Whereas return. When it fell to that, I was thinking it will fall further.
Yeah. I thought at least it'll last for another 6 months, 8 months key until business COVID is gone, until businesses recoup,
exactly.
Come back.
So clarity should come. Which direction are we going and when will things normalize?
I mean, I didn't understand that because even aviation sector, right? IRCTC, aviation companies, which were supposed to not, it's not supposed to be up even now because nothing's opened up yet, but it's still doing well. And even the bank, I was thinking...
It's still understandable, but aviation not understandable at all.
Yeah, so there's a lot of things that didn't connect for me, right? Even the banking stocks, right? NPS, I knew for a fact, will obviously go up because a lot of SMEs and MSMEs were suffering during the COVID time, right? And I'm like, how will that NPA look? And it was never being reflected. In fact, it was showing as good. So that is something that even people talk about inflation going up, but that's okay because that's, you know, thing with growth. But also there's a lot of money being pumped in on both sides.
See, one can understand why stock market is going up because, especially not in India, but India also mirrors what happens in the rest of the world. Like in America.
Huge.
And the government was giving lots of stimulus checks.
Yeah.
Now the money was there in people's hands. Nobody is moving out. Your spending is down, spending on entertainment, spending on eating out, and you're getting stimulus checks. So all this money found its way into the stock market.
Correct.
So that logic is there. Demand, supply make the price go up.
Correct.
But then the rest of them start following and start buying because market is going up. And that makes it a speculative bubble.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that happened with India as well, right? I think we saw the record number of DMAT accounts opening, number one.
Absolutely.
Then we went into that FOMO culture where first, the worst part or the scariest part was first knowledge nahi tha when they entered the market. So everyone thought, this is how the stock market is. This is how the stock bull run works. If I invest in the stock market, 25% to some minimum mana chahiye in a year. And I have seen some people saying I want 100% returns in a month. And that's when one crypto thing happened, everyone ran to crypto saying, acha 100%, 200%, 35 says 70 rupees. And I'm like, guys, this is not how a market works. If you get 15%, you should consider yourself, godly lucky, right? And here you're getting 25, 30% like this easily.
No. I mean, if Mr. Musk makes a statement and market goes up and he makes another statement and it comes down, tells you the fickle nature of that.
And a lot of people are betting on that. I'm like, are you his friend? Do you know when he's tweeting? But you're still taking your life, money, gambling it on, what tweet karega, I'm baking it, it'll go up. And I'm like, it's as equal to going to Goa, putting 32 or a Julia number and waiting for, that's the same odds, right? I mean, you're playing on those games. But I think that people understood now, because when the crypto market fell, a lot of people burned their hands and they realized, oh shit, okay. But now we have stock market coming up with a lot of IPOs. Almost every IPO going for a bumper listing kind of thing. So again, that's happening here. And I think that will take some time to... what is your take on IPOs? I understand why startups come out with... A lot of startups coming out with IPOs. I understand that perspective. But what do you think is coming up?
Have stopped investing in IPOs. Because, we are from an era where in the initial public offering, the shares were available at very, very close to face value.
Yeah.
those days, and this is all the time where InvestFest of mine started. Before that also, where I told you markets were booming, I also used to have one division which was into opinion polls.
Okay.
And one of the polls I used to do every week and publish it in the newspaper was on the IPOs of that week. And each week there were 10 to 15 IPOs.
At that time?
At that time. 10 to 15. And we used to do an opinion poll, what do you think? And we had a database for that opinion poll of about 300 brokers and so many investors and so many this. And I know for a fact that my opinion poll, which was published, used to influence decisions.
100%. Yes. There
are people read it with a check to sign and they would read the opinion poll that 85% people said it's not a good issue. They would change their mind and not invest. So it was molding opinion. Now, those days, there used to be an institution called CCI, Controller of Capital Issues.
Okay.
Anyone wanting to charge a premium had to take permission from CCI.
Wow.
Now imagine you are a promoter, you started your company, you issued a first public issue, 10 rupee share was sold for 10 rupees, and then you did phenomenally well, and your stock market price kept going up, it became say 300 rupees now, and now you want another public issue, so you'll obviously say, if people buy my share from me at 10 and sell it in the market for 300, I would like to get some benefit of that, so I want to sell my share at a premium.
Correct.
And you had to apply to CCI.
Correct.
And CCI had a ridiculous formula. They would apply formula. They say, yes, 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 you deserve a premium. I think you can sell your 10 rupee share at a 3 rupee premium, 5 rupee. Something as ridiculous as that.
That's weird.
Consequently, you could pick up gems at prices.
Yeah. But
those days, the stock market IPOs were oversubscribed hundreds of times also.
Oh, wow.
Or even thousands. Tata Timken, I remember, there was a collaboration between Tata's and Timken. So Tata Timken. I mean, many companies were oversubscribed 50 times, 60 times, 150 times, 200 times. Kinetic Honda was oversubscribed 150 times. Finolex was oversubscribed 60
All this was before DMAT?
Yeah. Before
DMAT. Proper physical.
DMAT ka ek aur story hai. We can't discuss here, but some powerful industrialists didn't let it happen. Because why? Because there were huge number of duplicate shares in circulation. I mean, it's a scary thing.
Wow.
Any promoter actually has the power of RBI. RBI can print money, print shares, and sell it whenever they want. Bogus shares. Mind you, if a thief does it, he'll get caught. But if the promoter himself does it, who's going to catch him?
Correct.
And if you do DMAT, all your duplicate shares would come out. So these industrialists never let it happen.
Wow.
So those days, you could get a wonderful share at 12, 13. So Tata Timken was oversubscribed, Shashank, 4,000 times.
Are you kidding me? My God.
That means, imagine if they wanted to raise 10 crores, they raised 40,000 crores.
Holy.
And they had to return 39,990 crores back.
Shit.
That company made a profit. And they were dividend in the first year. Why? Because that extra money they hung on for 2 months before they gave it back and on the interest they earned. Second year onward, the company started making a loss and it continued making a loss till the collaboration broke and Timken went back. But So I am used to those. And now the shares are sold at 600 premium. I can't imagine. Very often they get listed at below what you paid. So for me, the charm of IPO is out. I'd rather wait. And very often you can pick it up at lower price after it lists.
Most of the times, yes. Yes.
So my own investment started. My first ever, I remember. So I distinctly remember these things. When I'd become a fresh CA, that's when I started taking interest in stocks. And there was a company called SKF. Not SKF, ball bearing company. SKF, but this is ESKAYEF, pharmaceutical.
Okay.
And it had come out with a 10 rupee share at an 8 rupee premium.
Wow.
Currently 8 rupees.
Wow.
So I had applied for it. I'd made 3 applications, my name, mom's name, dad's name. These are the wrong things one does.
Yeah.
Improve your chances of
a lot of people are doing that now also. I've heard. Yeah.
So I managed to get 100 shares at 18 rupees, 1800. Now I look at the percentage and I don't look at the amounts. And then when a share is public issue comes out, rumors start going around in the market at what price it will get listed.
Correct.
And the rumor for SKF was it will get listed at about 80.
Oh my, that's too much.
When these rumors determine the price. So it actually listed at 80.
Are you serious? Oh my God.
First ever investment of my life. Bought 100 shares at 18, listed at 80, is a thrill. Every day watch the newspaper. Next day 90, then 100, then 120, then 150. It went up to 180.
Oh my
God. And kept watching.
Yeah. You didn't sell.
And then it came down 150, 130, 120, came down to 80. So what the hell is happening? Then at 80, I said, let me sell. But I sold half my holding, 50. Huh. So at 50, at 80 bucks is 4,000. I invested 1,800.
Yeah.
Sold half my holding at 4,000.
Yeah.
It started going up again. And soon went back to 180.
Oh my God. Then I sold
the remaining 50 for 9,000. So imagine an 1,800 investment got me 13,000 all within a matter of 3 months.
But that's not sustainable. That's not good, right?
No. But those days it was the
normal.
The problem was, Shashank, getting allotment was a big lottery, no?
Huh.
So it worked out a strategy. And I used to recommend in my columns that, put a kitty. Huh. Say, I want to increase, I'm going to invest in IP. Huh.
Hmm.
First public issue, come put it. Hmm. Most likely you won't get it because, like a lottery, heavily oversubscribed. But so many issues come. The moment it comes back, put it in the next one. It may come back. Put it in the next one. It may come back.
Hmm.
If you do 3-4 times, at least once you'll get allotment.
Correct. Correct.
And those days, there were this wonderful thing. I'm forgetting the name. These banks had come out with these instruments that don't invest money. Put the money in FD. And they would give you this instrument which you could use for applying for IPO. And if and when you get allotted, the FD will break.
So we
said, listen, do this. Put that 1 lakh in FD. Hmm. If you don't get allotment, you're earning FD interest. And even if once you get allotment and for out of 1 lakh, you get 30,000 rupees worth of shares, it will sell for so much, the average return would go to 20-25%.
I love banks. They'll make a product out of any need and demand.
A lot of innovations used to happen.
It's too good, this one.
Wonderful time to be in. And I used to be, because I was writing, I was always keeping track of what's happening.
Wow.
Then one fine day, they abolished CCI. Because these companies used to rebel. Who are you to tell us?
How much?
I mean, we're not idiots, yeah. If my share is selling for 300, I will not sell a 10 rupee share for 190 rupee premium. Nobody will buy. First of all, the moment a public issue happens, the number of shares goes up. The price should become half.
Correct.
Imagine the number of shares doubled.
Yeah.
So 300 rupee will become 150. Now, if I sell it at 150, they're still not attractive. So I'll probably get 70-80 bucks premium so that it's win-win. The buyer.
Little discount.
To tell me at what price to sell. One fine, they abolished CCI. And suddenly we went into what is known as a free pricing regime.
Wow.
Now, if I remember correctly, I always get confused between this name. It's either MRPL, Mangalore Refinery, or Tamil Nadu Petro, TNPL Petro. Hmm. One of these two, I'm forgetting. One of them was the first public issue to come out after the CCI got abolished. And a 10 rupee share was offered at 145 rupee premium.
Unheard
of. 155. Now, suddenly, earlier on, not only promoters used to criticize CCI, even investors used to criticize CCI. I don't know why. They were the biggest beneficiaries of CCI.
Yeah.
And suddenly, these investors started saying, now what do we do? Should we invest? There's nobody to, help us, guide us, hold our hands. We need something like a CCI. Now, this MRPL or TNPL, whichever it was, 155. You study the market price, it was 180, 185.
Hmm.
So somehow the issue got subscribed. Maybe slightly oversubscribed. No more hundreds of
times. No hundred, yeah.
Slightly oversubscribed. And the day it got listed, it started selling below 155. And there was a clamor. We need somebody to investor protection. Who will
protect? Oh, my God.
Now, to fill the void created by the abolition of CCI, SEBI was born.
Oh, wow.
That's how SEBI got created.
Wow.
Sorry, wow. I asked some other question. I took you on another
journey. No, this is, I mean, I'm so jealous because I wish I was there looking at all this. I get very excited.
In your temperament, Shashank, you would have had a ball those days.
This is so exciting. I'm looking at things now and I'm trying to make sense. I'm like, kya ho raha hai? Suddenly there's one bad bank coming.
It's become very, you know, very sterilized. All the laws. Like today you have a takeover court. You want to take over a company. But those days it was fun because they were hostile takeovers.
Hostile takeovers, yeah.
Identify promoters having less share, then somebody's like a predator comes. But I mean, it's terrible for the company being taken over, but it's great for an observer. You know, it's a great story. It used to be good fun. Those were the heydays of Dhirubhai Ambani. He was alive. Those were the heydays where Dhirubhai Ambani, Nasli Bhotia fight was going on. You know, every day some thing used to happen. So
finance was unbelievably exciting at that
point. Amazing. And I used to do InvestFest also, we were always on the, you know, top of it. We used to know straight from the horse's mouth what's going on. I've had meetings with Mr. Maya. Maya was M.R. Maya. He was the ED, Executive Director of Bombay Stock Exchange for 10 years. Wow. Twice he's come to Pune for us, twice to address InvestFest, once to address one of my convocations. I was talking to him that in the middle of your career, Harshad Mehta scandal happened. Well, what were you doing? Why couldn't you? We were watching. So I used to get this juicy inside
gossip. Yeah.
Today is not the day to share that. Some other day we'll do a session.
I think I need to come and sit with you one day and be like, please, this is so exciting, which you can't put in a book also. This is straight from the horse's mouth. No, I'll definitely 110% take you up on that offer. Yeah, I like listening to these things because it's very exciting and fascinating for a finance guy. Not about numbers. It's about understanding how the world works. And So a lot of things at that point, if you think, okay, this got abolished, this happened, that happened, and then this was born. What do you see happening today? What do you think that, okay, this is a shift or change that is happening today? Like, what is the thing that you're looking at right now and you're like, yeah, kuch samajh mein nahi aa raha hai. So this might become the next new thing or norm tomorrow.
What I don't understand today, number one, is cryptocurrency.
Makes sense. Yes.
Area which I don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
Today's times are really boring, actually. You know, nothing exciting.
Yeah, like listening to the stories, I'm like, yeah, the only thing is like Zomato IPO or IPO, let's talk about that. That's it.
We've lived through those times where India liberalized. Dr. Manmohan Singh changed the face of India.
Yeah.
Prior to that, what it was and post and then how things happened and how. So every day something used to happen.
Wow.
And India is going through a balance of payment crisis. And how are you trying to come out? And they come out with the schemes. Manmohan Singh came out with a brilliant move. You know, India had two problems. India had a problem of Forex. Some of your senior readers will know that before Dr. Manmohan Singh, for 10 days, Mr. Yashwant Sinha, you know, Chandrasekhar had formed a government. And Yashwant Sinha was the finance minister. And a Forex position was so precarious. We didn't have money to make 3 days of imports. 3 days. And he went and pawned our gold with the Bank of England. And borrowed money. And almost the first act of Dr. Manmohan Singh when he became finance minister was he somehow organized the money, returned the loan, brought the gold back. And then he came out with a brilliant move. And I used to write articles on those that he said, any money coming into the country in foreign exchange, no question asked. Wow. Now, this was literally an invitation to all the people who have black money stashed away.
Yeah.
That, you know, send your money out through Hawala.
Correct.
And some uncle, some friend, some cousin, make a demand draft and send it back.
Correct.
No question asked.
No question, nothing. No question. No tracking.
No. So now what happened? He killed two birds with one stone. Number one, this black money got converted to white. And number two, it came in the form of foreign exchange. So you sorted your foreign exchange problem. You sorted your... Because black money is something... One day you should do a session only on black money.
Yeah.
Black money is like cancer.
Yeah.
It spreads because if you don't pay tax, I mean, to avoid paying tax, you generate black money.
Correct.
It's not that you won't spend. But you'll spend and pay somebody else in cash.
Yeah.
That guy will spend. So it moves in parallel circles. So it's called the parallel economy.
Yes.
But government get nothing.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, once it becomes white, government earns from it in perpetuity.
Yeah.
So it's very, very important for it to happen.
It's very interesting. Yeah. But I think the lower income group suffers from this. I mean, from a black economy.
Country, will get no benefit. Now, if the government earns out of it, then government uses that money for development, for roads, for bridges, for power, whatever. But if the government doesn't get the money, how will they do it?
Correct.
I mean, the government has its own problem, the corruption, leakage, etc. But still, some money will come to the benefit of people. So black money is a curse.
Yeah.
So these things used to happen. Something like this earth-shaking would happen every day.
I'm getting so much FOMO. No, I'm getting FOMO of the past. Not of the present. I'm getting FOMO of the past. Shit. No, this is insane. So I have another question, right? Are you planning to write another book? Is there something else coming up?
I am. You know, I rightly or wrongly started feeling there are too many of my books out there. Another one, I'm cluttering the shelves. And what will happen? Instead of buying this, you'll buy that. So no
addition
happen. So I wasted the whole pandemic period and didn't think, but now I'm working on one. And I'm working
Is it going to be different? Like,
It has to be. Yes. And I'm working one on scams, my favorite area.
Oh, beautiful. That's, I think, I'll please send me a copy over there.
100%.
This is too good. I think this is the first time I'm getting a FOMO of the past.
Shashank, you are young. That's a great thing. You got the right attitude. You got the right level of interest. You got a very, very exciting future. No FOMO. Look ahead.
Yeah.
Equal amount. Scandals will keep happening. The world will never improve. What we experienced then, you're going to experience now.
Wow.
So it's your next 50 years are yours, Shashank.
So tell me one thing. If you were in my position today, right? What would you do today so that you can have a secure life in the future? And this is not only for me, it's for everyone in my...
You see, everybody has to inculcate a culture of savings and investments.
Correct.
And for that, they must understand. According to me, knowledge is the most important thing. Because people... I keep advocating investing in stocks is national duty. Everyone should invest. But I also say at the same breath that I'd rather you don't invest than invest foolishly. Because a foolish person, you know, who gets in because he sees everyone making money, gets in foolishly, 99% is going to burn his fingers.
Yeah.
But this kind of a guy comes out of stock exchange, cursing the stock exchange. Even though the fault was his. He said, this is a gambler's den. This is no place to invest. And he is a dangerous person.
Correct.
Because this person not only never invests again, but he goes and dissuades 10, 20, 30 other people. You know, I made the mistake. These guys are dangerous.
Hmm.
I feel the first prerequisite is knowledge.
Correct.
Even if you lose money, you've got to know why I lost. Because there's a lesson to be learned from everything. And if you take it as a lesson, then it'll probably help you. Because the best way to learn is by losing some money.
Yeah.
So maybe you lose a little money in the beginning and learn your lesson. So that when the big money is involved, you know what went wrong. So everybody has to learn the culture of saving and investment. If your audience are the youngsters, which I think they would be, guys, saving habit should start as early as possible from your first paycheck onwards.
Correct. How would you allocate it if you were there in today's
that
generation?
That depends on temperament, Shashank. I would not, thrust my views on anyone. First of all, it depends upon your risk
appetite.
Yeah, because I feel it doesn't matter how attractive an investment it is. Underlying one principle, remember, if you make that investment and you don't sleep at night, you should not have made it.
Smart.
Equity market and if you think there's a risk, but you can stomach it, all means do it. So if you are risk averse, stay away from equity, but ideally learn the market. Partly you are scared, your thinking is risky because you don't understand. So again, lack of knowledge, which is at fault. So if you learn the ropes, number one, first of all, with the moment a person starts earning, let's say above the tax-free limit, some of the earlier investments will have to be into tax-saving investments.
Correct.
For a person who's on his own, one of the finest investments used to be, today is less attractive but still nice, is a public provident fund account. I mean, if you take it as a retirement plan and make sure you keep investing in it till you retire or post that, not a short-term thing. Because the power of compounding kicks in over there.
Yeah.
Number two, everybody must understand insurance. Insurance is not investment, but almost everybody is underinsured or wrongly insured. And not no fault of theirs, because the people selling insurance are always selling you the wrong policies. They sell you policies where they make money, not necessarily which are
good. And they keep telling you'll get returns, which is not the case.
First of all, you talk about returns in the context of insurance. You lost the insurance is not an investment. It is supposed to be for insuring yourselves. Hmm. And therefore, what makes the maximum sense is a term plan.
Term plan.
Right?
Just direct life cover, nothing else.
Correct. Yeah. The next is the whole life policy.
Hmm.
Or at least if it's an endowment policy, it should mature in your 60s.
60s.
That makes sense. So insurance, you got to put some money aside. Hmm. Tax saving investments, among one of them I mentioned, is a
many. Hmm.
Then you, at the earliest, start putting a little bit into equity.
Hmm.
And preferably pick up long-term stocks so you can accumulate over the years.
Compound again.
Yeah, again, compounding kind of effect will happen to you. I am still in favor of a little bit of real estate.
Hmm.
Even though financially it doesn't seem to make much sense, but I think in the long run, it will help.
Yeah, I think that's a problem that a lot of current youngsters have because, you know, you put 20% upfront down payment and then take the remaining 70-80% in debt. And then you have to pay this EMI, even though now housing rates are the lowest interest rates. But, you know, people don't like this. They get scared of the EMI concept right now, even though everyone's spending.
So it depends upon each one's income pattern. If there is a consistency of income, they can do it.
Correct.
And I think at least one property one should have.
Should have.
And that also partially to balance your portfolio, even though financially it may not make much sense. But if you're taking it on housing loans, etc., and paying it through EMI and getting tax benefits, etc.,
out of correct. That.
And in correct. The long run, real estate has to go up. There's no two ways.
Yeah.
Principle of demand supply says
correct.
Demand of land is will always limited. Be there. Supply is not there at all. So eventually it has to go up.
Correct.
Even right now it may be going through a little plateau or sometimes even falling.
That's fine.
Then one should go a little bit into liquid funds because for who knew a pandemic like this will come in.
Emergency funds.
Emergency funds have to be there. Then if people understand the principles of inflation and all that, then I hate gold otherwise.
Hmm.
But gold from time to time makes sense. When you think it's becoming uncertain and everything is going weak, switch to gold, not physical, but in a DMAT format. Hmm. And then keep switching back, when things are improving. If you do that sensibly, there's a bit of money to be made over.
Hmm.
So between equity, between a little bit of real estate, between tax saving, between insurance, between some gold, bullion, whatever. And then come the other areas which are specialized, currency trading and stuff, which is not everyone's cup of tea.
Wow. Wow. This is incredible. No, I think, I think that's, I mean, I'm a little bit in euphoria of the 1992 era. I think that was like that. I should have been in that era, I think.
Yeah.
More than taking advantage, because I look at everything that's happening in the market right now from one education perspective. I look at global markets also to connect the dots, what's happening here. And then I see how I can take advantage. My final question is, ye samajh gaya, wo knowledge, ye knowledge hai. Abhi na, how can I take advantage of this? Right? Okay, something's falling in China. How did... Like, I mean, just to give an example, China, everything went bad. The chemical sector went really well here, right? But again, how do you know that's a long-term thing? Maybe it'll all go back to being normal the way we were. So a lot of questions, I mean, a lot of things like that, which keep, again, thanks, Anil sir. I'm going to take you up on this offer of coming there and just sitting and understanding all the things that happened there, which couldn't be said on the podcast. So I'm getting more FOMO on those things. But again, amazing. Thanks a lot. I think that's all I wanted to say. I mean, this was mind-blowing.
Pleasure, Shashank. Thanks once again for thinking of me, inviting me. It was a real pleasure talking to you.